Good afternoon. I'd like to call the City Council meeting of September 6, 2016 to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please call the roll. Councilmember Dominguez?
Here.
Councilmember Hotchkiss?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem White is not present. Mayor Schneider?
Here.
Councilmember Rouse?
Here.
Councilmember Hart?
Here.
And Councilmember Maria?
Here.
Okay. All right. Item number one. Item number one, employee recognition service award pins.
Thank you, Mr. Casey.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and council members. Each month, we like to recognize employees for achieving certain milestones of employment with the City of Santa Barbara. And so this month, I'd like to recognize employees with 5 years of service. Norma Cervantes, Administrative Analyst 1, Library Department. Lisa Clenenden, Litigation Paralegal, City Attorney Office. Aaron Denbrook, Police Officer with the Police Department. Alicia Guzman, Police Records Specialist, Police Department. Katie Hausnick, Public Safety Dispatcher 3 with the Police Department. And Marissa Lopez, Police Services Specialist with the Police Department. With 10 years of service, Nuvia Alvarez, Library Technician, Library Department. Artemio Aranda, Grounds Maintenance Worker 2, Parks and Recreation Department. Caroline Doza, Accounting Coordinator, Finance Department. Marlo DeRusso, Geographic Information Systems Technician, Administrative Services Department. Ryan Kelly, Harbor Patrol Officer, Waterfront Department. Holly Perea, Executive Assistant, Mayor and Council Office. Tim Petter, Waterfront Maintenance Crew Leader, Waterfront Department. And John Velasco, Parks Ranger, Parks and Recreation Department. With 15 years of service, Oscar Gonzalez, Police Officer, Police Department. Sean Hill, Police Sergeant, Police Department. Nicole Luvoff, Library Assistant 1, Library Department. Joshua Morton, Police Sergeant, Police Department. John Palka, Police Officer, Police Department. Charlie Venable, Police Officer with the Police Department. And Brian Walsh, Fire Captain with the Fire Department. With 20 years of service to the city, Kathy Taylor, Water Systems Manager, Public Works Department. With 25 years of service, Dave Henderson, Police Sergeant, Police Department. And Riley Harwood, Police Sergeant with the Police Department, who's here in person to receive his pin. With 30 years of service, Terry Yamada, Administrative Assistant, Parks and Recreation Department. And with 35 years of service, also to receive his pin in person today, Pat McElroy, our Fire Chief with the Fire Department.
Okay, before I step down to give the pins, I just want to take this opportunity. Over the past few weeks, we haven't been in council, and there's been some very serious fire activity, and just want to thank all of you that are right here. We can thank you in person for the mutual aid and all the work, not only in our own county, but throughout the state, and we know everyone pulls together. So thank you very much for both public safety and especially our fire department for, as always, keeping us safe during this high fire season. So thank you very much. He must have quite a few of these. Patrick McElroy began his career as a firefighter with the City of Santa Barbara Fire Department when he was hired on September 8, 1981. In 1990, Pat was the first firefighter to be promoted directly to the rank of captain. In 2008, he attained the rank of battalion chief. He was then promoted in 2011 to operations division chief and finally selected as fire chief on December 15, 2012. Other noted career roles include being voted Firefighter of the Year in 1987 and 1995, serving as president and board member of the Firefighters Association, and functioning as chairman of Firefighters for Better Government. Pat is currently serving as president of the Santa Barbara County Fire Chiefs Association. Pat's professional career includes notable incident responses to the Painted Cave Fire, the La Conchita landslide, the 1995 floods, the Northridge earthquake, the Los Angeles civil disturbances, and Hurricane Katrina. During 2006 to 2009, he was a member of the command staff of a national incident management team and helped manage wildfires as far away as Montana and Idaho. In 2008 and 2009, Pat served as the incident commander for the T and Jesucita wildfires. Most recently, Pat was assigned as liaison officer at the Soberanis Fire in Monterey County. In the past few months, he's been very proud to have been the main voice to advocate for Assembly Bill 1564, which was just signed into law by the governor on August 29th, requiring that 911 calls from cell phones be routed directly to a local dispatch center, saving valuable time. Pat has been recognized for his involvement in the community, which has included fundraising for 9/11, Hurricane Katrina recovery efforts, coaching for youth sports teams, and serving on the board of the Multimedia Arts and Design Academy at Santa Barbara High School and many other charitable organizations. Pat's a graduate of the University of California, Santa Barbara, and resides in the Santa Barbara area with his wife, Bonnie. They are the proud parents of three children, Darcy, Brendan, and Duffy. Chief McElroy, I'm so pleased to recognize your 35 years of service as well as your many personal and professional accomplishments. On behalf of the City Council and your fellow citizens, thank you and congratulations on this outstanding achievement. Thank you very much.
Well, that's a long time to be here. I just wanted to say how much I appreciate appreciated this career and the opportunity to serve the citizens of Santa Barbara and the various support we've received from councils, administrators, and staff through the 35 years I've been here. This is a great city. It's been a really great place for me to work, and I really enjoyed it. I mean, this is not a job I grew up dreaming of, you know, getting into as a firefighter. But it's something that I really come to love, and it's been a great way to live my life. I don't know what to say about these people. They're amazing. You have one of the better fire departments that I'm aware of. They prove it every day. And you not only the firefighting, you know, we get a lot of recognition, but the staff in our office, or Ron, Carol, Debbie, Carrie, Robin, they do an incredible job for us. And they do an incredible job for you as well. And like I said, that I don't... I talked to a lot of other fire chiefs. Our union guys talked to a lot of other unions, and we're pretty happy with the way things go here. I think we have a great relationship with council. We've got a solid relationship with the city organization at large, and there's a trust that goes a long way there to making what we do so much better and of value to the citizens. And of course. My wife and children, one of them can't be here today because he's working, and we're really happy about that. And the other two are on breaks from their jobs, so we're very happy about that, too. But unbelievable support through my career, understanding and patience with me during these 35 years, or most of them for these guys. But yeah, a lot of people come up here and say this isn't a job you do alone, and there's the family that's sitting over here, and then there's the family sitting over there, and they both mean the world to me. Thank you very much.
And another hero, Sergeant Harwood, come on up. Riley Harwood began his career with the City of Santa Barbara Police Department in September of 1991 as a Police Academy recruit. In February of 92, he graduated from the Police Academy. Riley's held many positions during his tenure at the Police Department, which include Downtown Foot Patrol, Field Training Officer, Patrol, Tactical Patrol Force, Crisis Negotiation Response Team, and Administrative Sergeant. He's currently assigned as the Community and Media Relations Sergeant. Riley's also a driving force in the efforts to fund a memorial statue to be placed on the front steps of the police department. The statue would recognize officers who've been lost by the Santa Barbara Police Department in the line of duty. Riley's commendations include the Santa Barbara County Mental Health Association Annual Award for his work in establishing the police department's restorative policing program and the Downtown Organization of Santa Barbara Citizen of the Year Award for his collaborative efforts. He was twice awarded the Optimist International Law Enforcement Award for his distinguished and dedicated service to our community. Riley also volunteers his time to the community as a member of two nonprofit organizations, Goleta Valley Historical Society and the Santa Barbara Historical Museum. Riley's married to his wife, Dasiev, and has two sons, Jack, age 12, and Skyler, age 4. His hobbies include competitive shooting. He's recognized as a Santa Barbara Police Department Distinguished Master Shooter and travel. Sergeant Riley Harwood, it is my pleasure to honor you today for your 25 years of service to the city of Santa Barbara. On behalf of the City Council, we thank you, congratulate you on this admirable achievement. Thank you so much.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, first off, I need to thank everyone from the fire service for coming to support me today. That really means a lot to me. Twenty-five and a half years ago, I was on the verge of graduating from UCSB and had made the decision to pursue a career in law enforcement. But interestingly, I had no desire to be involved in municipal policing. The idea just didn't appeal to me. Nevertheless, to broaden my outlook, I took an Administration of Justice class at Santa Barbara City College that at the time was taught by now retired SBPD Sergeant Rick Abney. And in that class was the PD's training and recruitment cadet, who is now Lieutenant Mary Linda Arroyo. And anyway, during one of the breaks in the class, Mary Linda approached me, said that the PD was hiring, and asked if she could bring me an application. And so I thought to myself, well, why not? And here I am 25 years later. There are a few things I would have done differently in my career, but looking back, I can say for certain that this was the career that was meant for me. While wearing the uniform of a Santa Barbara police officer, I've witnessed the very best and the very worst of the human condition, and I've experienced every emotion to the extreme. I've fallen short of saving the world, but I've had a profound impact on a handful of lives, and that has made this journey very, very meaningful. I have to confess that when I came to work here, I knew very little about the department. I feel fortunate that that what I found was an agency that places its highest priority on the quality of its employees and the quality of service that it provides. In 25 years, I've had the opportunity to travel to many police departments and to train and work with their personnel. A number of those places had nicer facilities, better equipment, and more money, but I've yet to find a place where I walked away thinking that they had better people or did better police work than we do. I just have not seen it. And I'm here today in large part because I want you and the people of Santa Barbara to know that we have an exceptional police department. So in closing, to you, Madam Mayor, council members, Mr. Casey, Mr. Colon, and all of your predecessors with whom I've had the privilege to serve this community, thank you for your continued support. And to the people of Santa Barbara, I would like to say thank you for the trust and confidence that you've seen fit to place in me. It's been an honor to serve you. Thank you.
Item 2, proclamation declaring September 2016 Suicide Prevention Month.
Come on up. Good afternoon. Worldwide, there are more deaths by suicide than by homicide and war combined. And in the United States, one person dies by suicide every 12.3 minutes, with 42,773 deaths by suicide in our country. Suicide is the second leading cause of death for 15 to 24-year-olds in the United States and is the 10th leading cause of death for people of all ages. And in Santa Barbara, suicide was reported as the fifth leading cause of premature death. Each person's death by suicide intimately affects at least six other people, with over 200,000 newly bereaved each year. And with great many suicides are preventable and can be reduced through awareness, education, and treatment. So therefore, I, Helene Schneider, by virtue of the authority vested in me as mayor of the city of Santa Barbara, California, do hereby proclaim September as Suicide Prevention Month in Santa Barbara in support and recognition of the International Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. And thank you, Gina, for all your amazing work in this capacity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and everyone on council. All through the years that I've received this proclamation, I want to say that I've been incredibly supported by the members of this council on this issue, which is not, you know, a happy issue to talk about. But I must say that over the months and the years that I've worked in suicide prevention, it's a collaborative effort. And it's a collaborative effort with law enforcement, with first responders, with city council, with mental health agencies, all of us working together to help deal with this public health epidemic, which is on the increase not just in Santa Barbara, but nationally and internationally. So for the month of September, the Glendon Association has collaboratively worked with the leading mental health agencies and direct service providers to put on a series of educational events that I invite everyone to come to, including one tomorrow night in Casa de la Raza, where I know Jason Dominguez and Kathy Maria will be, but there'll be many other people speaking to that community about how we can get services. And also an Out of the Darkness walk on Sunday, which Mayor Schneider will be at, as she is every year, and walking to help bring awareness to suicide prevention. I brought materials of all the other events that are going on, and I hope that you would participate. Contact me if you want to know how you can get more involved. And thank you again to everyone in this community for helping us to fight this fight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, are there any changes to the agenda?
No, Madam Mayor.
Okay, public comment. I have a speaker slip here from Jose Gonzalez. We have 2 minutes here at the podium. Come on up.
Hi, thank you. I'm here, as you're well aware, that the taxi business and the transportation, commercial transportation business, has been hijacked by those technology or transportation companies that are Uber and Lyft. And as a voter and just a man, I work at the airport, and we are having trouble with these people coming in there just taking our rides. We don't have any income anymore. So we want to make you aware that we believe at the airport that they're breaching the contract between the airport administration and the taxi drivers that are permitted, that pay their fees, that are sitting on the line, and we want something to happen with that. We want to understand why it is that they can just come in. They're unregulated. There's all kinds of lawsuits against these people all over the place, including from their drivers. The labor board in California has said that they are actually employers, and they're saying that their drivers are actually subcontractors or independent contractors. Now, we're independent contractors. We have to compete against them, but they have a big advantage where they could set prices low and high, which is against the antitrust laws of the United States. A federal law does not allow us to set our prices so low that we eliminate competition. They're doing that, and they're actually getting sued for that right now. So I just wanted you to know that we have a notice that we like to present to the board from the airport taxis with some factual information about things that are happening in other cities and also some other factual information regarding well, how they work and the antitrust laws that they're breaking. So with that, I'd like to leave this with you guys and
give to the clerk right here. That's fine. Thank you very much.
Feedback from you guys at some point.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. That's the only public comment speaker slip I have. So we move on to the consent calendar, and Sarah has a whole lot to read.
Item 4, subject introduction of ordinance approving supervisor's memorandum of understanding, recommendation that council ratify the labor agreement with the supervisory employees bargaining unit through introduction and subsequent adoption of, by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara amending the 2012 to 2016 memorandum of understanding between the City of Santa Barbara and the Santa Barbara City Supervisory Employees Bargaining Unit adopted by ordinance number 5587. And previously amended by ordinance numbers 5623 and 5704, and extending the term through June 30, 2017. Item 5, subject introduction of ordinance granting easements to County Flood Control District as part of the Mason Street Bridge replacement. Recommendation that Council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara approving the granting of easements on city-owned properties to the County of Santa Barbara Flood Control and Water Conservation District for flood control and all related purposes, and authorizing the City Administrator to execute the grant deeds in a form approved by the City Attorney. Item 6, subject introduction of ordinance establishing speed limits. Recommendation that Council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara amending Chapter 10.60 of the Municipal Code by revising Section 10.60.015 and establishing prima facie speed limits on certain portions of Anacapa Street, De La Vina Street, La Colina Road, Loma Alta Drive, Furano Drive, and Llano Nolly Street. Item 7, introduction of an ordinance amending municipal code provisions pertaining to harbor slip assignments. Recommendation that Council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara amending the municipal code by amending Section 17.20.005 of Chapter 17.20 of Title 17 pertaining to harbor slip assignments. Item 8, introduction of ordinance for advertising concession agreement with Clear Channel Airports. Recommendation the Council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara approving and authorizing the Airport Director to execute a 5-year concession agreement with 1 5-year option with Interspace Services, Inc., DBA Clear Channel Airports, to manage advertising sales at Santa Barbara Airport, SBA. Item 9, introduction of ordinance approving Memorandum of Understanding with Police Unit. The Council ratify the Memorandum of Understanding between the City and the Santa Barbara Police Officers Association by introduction and subsequent adoption of, by reading of title only, an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara adopting a Memorandum of Understanding between the City of Santa Barbara and the Santa Barbara Police Officers Association for the period of July 1, 2016 through June 30, 2019. And item 10, resolution for acceptance of easements for the Gutierrez and De La Guerra Streets Bridge replacement projects. Recommendation the Council adopt by reading of title only, a resolution of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara to acquire and accept permanent and temporary construction easement interests located at 123 West Gutierrez Street and 317 and 326 West De La Guerra Street, and authorizing the City Administrator to execute all agreements and all related documents as necessary in a form approved by the City Attorney.
Thank you. Without further addition, we'll waive further reading. We had a couple of items that needed to be pulled off. I think, Mr. Hotchkiss, you want 6 and 14. Mr. Rouse, you need to abstain from item 7. Why don't we do item 7 first, get that out of the way? This is, I think it was already read, it's the ordinance amending municipal code provisions pertaining to harbor slip assignments. So, Mr. Rouse?
Madam Mayor, I am a slip holder, so I will be abstaining from this item.
Okay. So if we could have a motion for item 7.
Move item 7, Madam Mayor.
Second.
Moved by Murillo, second by Hotchkiss. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any opposed? And
abstain.
One abstention, Mr. Rouse. Okay. Item 6 was the ordinance establishing speed limits. Mr. Hotchkiss.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Speed limits are important and get a lot of attention, as rightly they should. So when we're actually lowering a speed limit, people want to know why, and it thinks it's not an arbitrary choice on our part. In fact, these limits are established by people who are actually driving those roads now. But to better explain this, I asked Mr. Bailey if he'd come forward and walk us through each place and tell us why we're either keeping the speed limits the same one place or reducing them than others. Mr. Bailey, please.
Sure. Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hotchkiss. Yes, this is a routine update of speed limits that we do. The city maintains about 80 speed zones across the city, and they have to be recertified every 7 years. So we do about 11 or 12 updates every year. Oftentimes the...
When we say recertified, we go out and measure the speeds, correct?
Correct.
All right.
Yeah, and I'll explain what that looks like in a sec. So every year we do about 11 or 12 speed surveys, and most often the speeds stay the same. But just like this year happens to be, there happens to be a few changes being made. And so those changes have to be approved by the City Council so they can be entered into the Santa Barbara Municipal Code. So how we establish speed limits in California, I just put a few slides together. We have the California Vehicle Code, and that is that governs all the operation of streets throughout the state of California. So it doesn't matter if it's a large city like Los Angeles, if it's Caltrans, Santa Barbara County, City of Santa Barbara, every agency is subject to the California Vehicle Code. And the Vehicle Code goes into so much detail as it actually tells us how we have to set speed limits in the city. And what it tells us is we have to set the speed limit based on the 85th percentile speed. And like I said, it has to be updated every 7 years. So we often get questions. No,
put that in plainer English, I could say. 85 out of 100 people are driving at a certain speed. That's
yes,
where we set the speed
I'm
limit.
Just going to show you how we figure out what the 85th percentile speed is. What we do to figure out the 85th percentile speed is we actually go out to the street being studied with a LIDAR gun, just like the police use, and we get 100 samples. That's a free-flowing, unimpeded vehicle traveling down the street. We measure them, 100 vehicles coming down the street. Then we go back to the office, and we tally them, and we list them from low to high. So just in this hypothetical, number one would be the lowest, say at 17 miles an hour, 2, 3, 4, as the list climbs. Once we get to number 85, just say that 85th was 28 miles an hour. That's the 85th percentile speed. So 85% are below, 15% are above. And what the vehicle code says we have to do with the 28 mile an hour, 85th percentile speed is round it to 30 miles an hour, the nearest 5 mile an hour, unless there's some special things going on in the street, like if there's a high collision rate or a really high pedestrian activity, then we can round it down to 25 miles an hour. Another way to look at the 85th percentile speed, if we graph all of our speeds, we usually get a nice bell-shaped curve. The premise is that with the 85th percentile speed is that most drivers are reasonable, and they will drive at a speed that's reasonable for roadway conditions. So that's most everybody here in the middle, which is the 50th percentile. And the people that would be unreasonable are the people beyond the 85th percentile speed. And just why does the state set these rules? The state has a really strong policy in place against speed traps. And a speed trap is setting the speed limit so low that reasonable drivers, everybody right in the middle there, become speeders just by setting the speed limit too low. So that's what the state wants us to avoid. And speed limits are a reflection of actual operating speeds. So when in this case where we have 12 speed surveys that we did this year, all of the speed limits that we've determined are an actual reflection of the speeds that we've measured in the field. So does that answer your questions?
Yes.
Great. Great. You don't need to vote on this separately then. Good. Okay. And then item 14, I don't think you got that one, if you could read item 14.
Item 14, subject agreement for sanitary sewer route control services.
Great. Mr. Hotchkiss.
This has been such a successful program, I thought we ought to illustrate that with a little talk about the actual effects and how we measure this kind of route control. So would you kind of walk us through a little bit and explain to everybody out there?
Thank you. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the council. My name is Lisa Arroyo. I'm the wastewater system manager. And the chemical route foaming program was initiated back in 2014. We started with an initial 1 mile, and then as a total for 2014, we did about 14 miles of chemical route foaming on our mains that had the highest amount of routes found during the cleaning process. We went on in 2015 and did an additional 21 miles. For a total of about 35 miles to date. That is about 900 sewer segments. One of the measures of the program's success is whether or not we are reducing our sanitary sewer overflows due to roots, especially on those lines that we've chemically root treated. We found that since we have done those 900 pipes, we have had one overflow or one spill on those 900 pipes since then. If you look at years past, that same sample set of 900 pipes, we were upwards of 52 overflows on those pipes. So we measure this program as a great success, and we look forward to continuing it in the future.
Thank you. I wish all our resolutions or solutions were so successful. Thanks for explaining that.
You're welcome.
Thank you. We need a motion for the balance of the consent calendar.
So moved.
Moved by Hotchkiss, second by Rouse. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you. And move on to item number 22.
Item 22, subject public hearing and expansion of residential permit parking near Santa Barbara City College.
Mr. Dayton.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, Council Members. My name is Rob Dayton from Public Works, in this case, Downtown Parking. Downtown Parking manages the residential parking program, which is a resident-oriented protection program for people who in the neighborhood have excessive parking from employees and in sometimes students. Downtown, it's mainly employees, but in Area M, which is on the Mesa, it's the students from Santa Barbara City College. We came to you back in December 8th and got direction from you to look at the expansion of Area M, specifically at the request of some residents on the 400 and 500 blocks of La Marina. At that time, we looked at a much broader area of expansion, and we're back to you with a recommendation to just expand it to include those residents. I would like to introduce to you Sarah Clark from Downtown Parking to give you a presentation on that process that we embarked on.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. As Mr. Dayton said, I'm Sarah Clark from the Downtown Parking Program, and I'm here to just follow up on that direction that you gave us back in December to explore the expansion of Parking Area M on the Mesa. So just a little bit of background. The Resident Permit Parking Program preserves parking for residents on the streets. It is a tool that we use to manage parking on the street in areas where we have a mix of different uses. So in the case of Area M, this would be on the Mesa in the neighborhoods that are adjacent to City College, where we have commuter students who come and they park on the streets there during the day. This process is governed by Municipal Code Section 10.46, as the whole program is, and the program is really resident-driven. So we do not initiate the expansion of a permit parking area or establishing a new permit parking area on our own as a city. We wait for the residents to tell us that that's something that they want. And then once a permit parking area is established, we never go and post signs without the express request of a majority of residents. So just because we've expanded a permit parking area or established a permit parking area, we never post signs unless we get a petition signed by residents of 70% of the homes on that street. So it's something that the residents really have to want in order for us to go in and implement that program there. So these permit parking areas have to be designated by City Council. And in the case of Area M, that happened in 1991, as we've said, to address the student parking impacts up there. So these are the current boundaries of Area M in the gray area here. And the blocks that are highlighted in green, as you can see, are the blocks where we currently do have permit parking restrictions posted. So you'll notice that not every block in Area M is posted. And again, that's because it is a resident-driven program, and those are just the blocks that where the residents have not requested that. So now that we've posted most of the blocks in this area, we have seen those student parking impacts continue to creep, and now they've creeped to outside of that boundary. So as a result of this, residents of the 400 and 500 blocks of La Marina petitioned us to be included in Area M so that they could get permit parking on their street. Around the time we received that request from those residents, we had also received several more informal complaints from other residents on the Mesa who also lived outside Area M about student parking on their street. So at the time when we came to you back in December, we recommended studying a much larger area in order to determine whether there was resident interest outside of just those two blocks in also having those boundaries adjusted and being included in Area M. This is why when we first came to you, we requested to study the purple area here on the screen. Now, when we actually went to the field and conducted the study, we modified that slightly. These two streets, I don't know if you can see here, Vista Pacifica right there, those are private streets, which is why there's that little donut hole in there, so there's no public parking on those streets. This street over here is a public street, but it's mostly senior and condominium housing. It wouldn't really be an appropriate place for permit parking. And then we also eliminated this little area of Santa Cruz Boulevard down here And that was because that was mostly beach and parking, and so we didn't want to interfere with that. So this is the area we ended up studying. And after we performed that study, we also conducted public outreach, and then we're back to you today to present the transportation engineer's report and hold that public hearing. So our parking study was taken, we conducted between March 14th and March 18th. During the week, we took vehicle counts three times a day, 9 o'clock a.m. to 10 o'clock a.m., 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock p.m., and then 3 o'clock to 4 o'clock p.m. We would go through, drive all of the streets, count every vehicle that was parked on the street, and then use that to determine the percentage occupancy on the street. The reason we studied during those during those hours is that we're looking for peak hours. That's when parking impacts do peak due to student parking. Those are also the hours during which permit parking is currently enforced on the Mesa. So we're really only constraining our study to the times when we do have parking enforcement up there and we can actually do something to mitigate those impacts. So we consider parking impact if 80% or so of the spaces are occupied during on a particular block during peak hours. So here are the here are the results of that study. To no one's surprise, really, there's not a whole lot of impacts the further away you get from City College. So the streets here that are highlighted in green are ones where we had 25% or less occupancy during peak hours. These streets also did not have significant student impacts. These are streets where less than half of the on-street spaces were full during those peak hours. Then we have the streets where things start to get a little bit more crowded. So these orange and these red streets are the streets that were most impacted by student parking. So we really saw the impacts concentrated in two areas. We saw them on this 400 block of La Marina, and then we saw them a little bit on the east end of the 1200 block of San Miguel. So the coloration here is a little bit misleading in that, for example, for the 1200 block of San Miguel, the area towards the east end of that block is very heavily impacted. It was often over capacity during peak hours. However, towards the west end, there really were not a whole lot of impacts. So on balance, it looks like it's a little bit emptier than it actually is on the street. Sort of similar with the 400 block of La Marina, again, closer to Cliff Drive. You see it's pretty much completely parked up during the day. As you go further up the hill, it peters out a little bit. We also conducted public outreach to get resident feedback up in the area. So we put up a website with all sorts of information. We also mailed notice to owners and residents of the homes, both in the existing area and in the proposed area M boundaries. We solicited their feedback via email, phone, and on the website. And we invited them to come to a public meeting that we held over at the library on May 25th. So at that public meeting, we gave them more information about the project, and we also solicited feedback via a brief written survey that we handed around to everybody. So we learned from that feedback that there is very strong support still from the residents of Upper La Marina to be included in Area M, but the other residents were not supportive of that expansion. The only place where we had sort of a little flicker of interest was over on the east end of that 1200 block of San Miguel. But across the whole distance of the block, we did not see enough interest that to warrant us recommending to include that area in the expansion. So the municipal code outlines four specific criteria that we consider when we are deciding whether to establish or expand a permit parking area. Those are whether or not the residents want and need permit parking. So that would be the parking occupancy study as well as the resident feedback that we collected. We look at the availability of on-street parking for residents and whether there are other users, such as students in this case, who are impacting that parking. We look at whether or not it's feasible for us to even enforce that, whether the city has the resources to do that, and whether that would have potential impacts on places, on other streets that are outside of the parking area. So is it going to push that parking onto other streets? We also look at whether or not there's a better, an easier, a less intrusive solution to the problem. So in this case, as we've discussed, we had strong support from 400 to 500 La Marina, and we also saw impacts there, which is why we're recommending to just expand the Area M boundaries to include those two blocks. We do see a lot of student parking impacts. The enforcement should not be a significant additional burden. It's two blocks that are already contiguous with the existing area. And short of actually banning all on-street parking there, there's no other other route to solve that problem. So in conclusion, these are the boundaries that we'd recommend, and we're happy to take questions on that.
Thank you. Questions? Ms. Maria.
Thank you, Mayor Schneider. Was it Ms. Clark?
Yes.
Nice to meet you. So what did people say when they said they don't want the restrictions? That I'm curious.
Sure. Madam Mayor, Councilman Murillo. The residents outside largely did not wish to be burdened by a parking program. So by having to purchase permits, they largely felt that
this is an
issue that the city should deal with in other ways, or that City College should deal with, or that it's a burden that City College should have to bear for creating those impacts on their streets. So it wasn't necessarily, I mean, certainly some people, you know, were just not seeing impacts, and so they didn't see how this was relevant to them. But then in other cases, in a lot of other cases, there was quite a bit of frustration about the impact that City College was having on that neighborhood, and they did not want to have permit parking in order to address that.
And in general, did you notice when you walked the streets, did they have long driveways and off-street parking? Was that part of the reason why they weren't really suffering from parking congestion?
Generally, yes. The homes in this area are largely single-family residential homes. They almost all have off-street parking available to them. Certainly, a lot of people still choose to avail themselves of the on-street parking. However, a lot of the complaints that we get up in that area, M, are not just about the residents not having parking, because generally they do in their driveway. We hear a lot also about people speeding, people throwing trash, people loitering, sleeping in cars, people walking through yards, things like that. So a lot of times these residents are really concerned with some of the other impacts that they have from students driving around the neighborhood and searching for parking.
Okay. I'm curious about sleeping in cars, like napping in between classes or homelessness.
I have gotten complaints about both.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Mr. Hotchkiss.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, we certainly want to honor what people are asking for. I am curious, about how many cars do you think would be affected by this? In other words, how many would it free up? How many spaces?
So, Madam Mayor, Councilman Hotchkiss, we would estimate that if we were to post permit parking on the 400 and 500 blocks of La Marina, it would likely displace somewhere around 20 vehicles onto adjacent streets. So we don't really know exactly what that impact would look like in terms of where all of those people would go. Chances are they would not all go to the same place. They would probably disperse across multiple other streets in the area if they were to continue driving. So it's something we do intend to keep an eye on to see if those people, you know, are moving out or creating congestion elsewhere. So
yeah, can we watch that? Because I think, you know, neighboring streets are going to want to know about that too.
Yeah, and that's something, you know, we're processing this request right now. Certainly residents in the future, if they change their minds and they decide that, yes, they are interested in participating, then we are here to accept that request and go through that process with them.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Yeah, I attended that meeting, and that was a rather impassioned Mesa crowd. A lot of misunderstanding prior to staff presentation. Staff did, I think, a fabulous job of explaining and helping diffuse some of the misunderstanding. But one of the operative questions, of course, is when you restrict parking there, will it not push parking somewhere else? And I think part of the frustration that the neighborhood is feeling is that we in the city are trying to solve a problem that's really being propagated by a state agency, and they kind of shrug their shoulders like, what do you want us to do? So my question would be, what else in the menu of potential programs or City College suggestions? We've had a lot of issues up there lately. We're about ready to launch SNAP program. We've had the Beach City Project and now this, and they all seem to help add a little fuel to the fire. What about from the other side? I know the City College is going to participate in the SNAP program, but what about this issue with vehicles? Have there been any thoughts, suggestions, or ideas on how they may help to mitigate the issue?
So, Madam Mayor, Councilman Rouse, City College does have a very active transportation management program, and it's something that the city does participate in. you know, they have the bus subsidy program with MTD to encourage people to take buses. They have a lot of incentives for people to carpool to campus. They get preferential parking if they carpool, for example. You know, there's been a lot of work with encouraging people to bicycle to campus. There is SB Bike, I believe, has a little outpost on campus to help out people with their bikes. There are any number of efforts that are sort of constantly underway, and the city is actually we have used some of our parking lot space for shuttle programs where people could actually use satellite parking and then shuttle to campus. So to try to reduce the number of people who are driving to campus. So that's certainly something that I know that they take very seriously and that we have worked with them on to try to sort of address those impacts before they happen.
Well, I've seen that, and I've seen the different, and their TDM is actually controlled and monitored by them, though, right? We don't really have any say over what their TDM does or doesn't do, right?
That's
correct in that? And yet we've seen this you know, exponential growth over the years, and living kind of near the area myself, have seen anecdotally just the growth and the incursion of cars into those neighborhoods. So with those programs in place, it still seems like we're falling, or they're falling short of helping to mitigate those impacts. So, and I don't know how many more MTD buses. Is the bus ridership pretty well subscribed? Are the buses full coming in and out every day at Isla Vista?
I could not give you exact numbers on that. Incidentally, I believe that it is very well subscribed.
It is so much so, in fact, that we went to the articulated bus, and maybe you've seen it, which is an extra long bus. MTD assigned that to that route for that purpose because it is well used.
Right, and I know that's a very, that's also an expensive solution as well. So it's a head scratcher. I mean, I don't know what we would possibly do, what they could possibly do about it, but it seems like the neighborhood is feeling just a little extra burdened by the fact that there doesn't seem to be something that's forthcoming that's going to, you know, when we're going to we finally do the 400 or 500 block of La Marina, and that, well, they're just going to move to the next block and on down to the west. So, seems like it's going to be an ongoing discussion.
Okay, I'm going to go to public comment. We have two speakers, so why don't we do that first, and then we'll go to Mr. Hart and Mr. Hotchkiss. Kim Friley, and then Joan Price. Welcome.
Madam Mayor, members of council, my name is Kim Friesley. I live in the 500 block of La Marina, just about halfway up the cul-de-sac. Little past halfway. I've lived there for over 30 years, and over the years I've noticed the creep that is referenced. Started out to a few cars just above Cliff Drive, and now they're often in front of or even past my residence. I see the students parking in the morning or getting into their cars in the afternoon. Many of the cars have SBCC parking stickers, but as you know, SBCC does not guarantee a parking space with those. They have only a limited number of parking spots, even with their parking structure. And it's just for the people who get there in time, it allows them to park there. But if they don't get there early in the day, then they don't have a place, so then they go elsewhere. So, but we know that those are students, most of them, that we're seeing parking in the morning. This affects availability of street parking to residents' guests and also to service personnel, including contractors and gardeners and caregivers. SBCC is supported in large part by taxes. A certain portion of that is to pay for a contract with MTD, which provides the student use, unlimited student use of the MTD buses with their student ID. I support those taxes. I've benefited from City College, and I also benefited from subsidized MTD when I was a city employee and often used the buses. And Mr. Rouse, I can attest to the fact that the City College students use those buses. That could be I sometimes avoid the busy times on Cliff Drive when I know that it's going to...
Great. Your time's up, but thank
and
you.
I support this. I urge a yes vote on this.
Thank you. Joan Price? Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and members of council. I live up at 550 La Marina, so it's up near the top, so we don't get that much parking impact, but my neighbors do. And the concern I have is when you have students parking in the neighborhood, I've almost been hit twice by students pulling a quick UE to get a parking spot. So I'm very careful when I drive down my street to avoid being hit. And we've had a numerous fatal accidents, as you know, in the La Marina Cliff Drive area, and it's a very dangerous corner. And so the parking permit will help that. I also know that, as Kim said, there is not enough parking at City College. I've gone to their master plan meetings. Their master plans have a lot of buildings. They do not have new parking in their plans. And I would encourage you, as council members, to encourage them that if they're going to put anything further on the ballot issue for bonds, they better have parking. Thank you.
Okay, so it's back to council. Mr. Hart?
Yeah, I think this is a great proposal, and I appreciate the work that staff did to really reach out to the neighborhood and have the conversation. I think it was kind of counterintuitive to me that there wasn't more impact in the neighborhoods adjacent, so this precise solution, it seems really appropriate. Couple of things that I think are important for folks to begin to understand. There has certainly been a lot of growth at Santa Barbara City College in enrollment over a very long period of time, but the most recent trend is a significant decline in enrollment at City College. And I know that's kind of counterintuitive to people's experience, but it's important, I think, to be very accurate and factual about the reality of what's going on. And unfortunately, you know, despite this really excellent staff report, there was a reference to that in it, and speaking to the fact that City College's enrollment is increasing, and if that trend were to continue, this would be a bigger problem. That isn't accurate, and it's important for us to be accurate about these kind of things. The decline in enrollment may not mean that there are fewer cars, though, because those things are completely unrelated. And City College is in a really difficult box in that regard because the California Coastal Commission has prevented them from building parking structures. That is the reason why they have additional development that's going on. And most of that is, frankly, to replace old buildings and not necessarily add actual classroom space or accommodate additional students. It's just simply old buildings that are worn out that need to be replaced. But they are constrained by the tension between building additional parking spaces and encouraging more students to drive, as opposed to investing in alternative transportation and doing the things that Ms. Clark described that they're doing. So I think there's a tendency for us to kind of do the whipping of City College in terms of their impacts in the community. There is a much more complex story involved in that than we're really talking about today. And I think this very precise solution is appropriate and a good idea, and I'm supportive of it.
Mr. Hotchkiss?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm sure we're not alone in facing this kind of challenge among cities. Is it our responsibility or the colleges to talk to other venues and see if there are some creative solutions that we may not have thought of that might help us?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hotchkiss, we have been engaged with City College and talking to them about solutions on an ongoing basis. And one of the solutions that could be really profound on the transportation end and the parking is to have housing located nearer to the college. One of the challenges we have is the student population is located pretty far away, in Isla Vista in many cases, which is why the bus line works. But the challenge with having a campus without housing is our big challenge when it comes to both the Castillo Interchange, which at the beginning of college, if you just witnessed that in the last month, is just horrendous, where a lot of students are trying to park and trying to get to the college.
No, but what I meant is other communities, Pasadena, wherever, have met the same challenge or are trying to, might they have solutions that we have not thought of? And is it our responsibility or the colleges to take a look for those comparable situations and solutions therein?
I think it's both our responsibility. You know, we're managing a city, they're managing a college. In other communities, as Mr. Hart pointed out, Councilmember Hart, is we're in the coastal zone, so it's a lot more complicated in the coastal zone. The city colleges that I'm familiar with down south have built pretty significant parking structures. Even City College has proposed to build a parking structure in the past, and the Coastal Commission has told them that they're not to do that. So those are the types of solutions that the parking solutions that have been sought in the past.
Well, Mr. Rouse is right. We're not solving the problem here, so we need to keep looking. Let's keep trying. This is a good step. Thank you.
Ms. Murray?
I'm prepared to make a motion, Madam Mayor. I have some comments as well. I move staff recommendation A and B.
Okay, let's get a second. Okay, moved by Murillo, second by Hart. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'd like to acknowledge a couple of emails that came in supporting the proposal. And then also, I'm the city council liaison to the MTD bus agency, and they are reporting fewer a decrease in ridership of City College students. But you're right, Councilmember Hart, I'm not sure I've seen the breakdown if they're not riding from UCSB into campus. And that's a great question, though, for MTD. Can they break it down? Who's not riding their buses anymore? And what does that mean to us in terms of parking congestion? I acknowledge Susan LaFond from the Westside Community Group, our neighborhood association. We have regular meetings, a parking committee meeting, and our group is concerned about City College students parking in the Lower West area. If you park down there, Coronel Place, Rancheria, it's a short walk up the hill through that pathway next to McKinley School, you know, to get up to the college. So we've talked about a residential parking permit program in that area. The West Side also just has a lot of cars, and so it's delicate, as you know, Mr. Rouse, talking to people about what works, you know, will this work? But Councilmember Rouse and I are talked earlier, and we want to go to our respective neighborhood associations and ask for Anthony Beebe, is the new president of City College, to talk to our neighborhoods at a meeting. Our Mesa neighborhood, or I call them the Mesa Village meetings, your group, and keep the dialogue going with the community and the City College. Yes, their numbers are down, but the college does create parking demand and housing demand, and we can't ignore that. And so we had a great thing going with the that task force that was meeting related to the noise ordinance. And on that note, I'd like to acknowledge that City College gave $100,000 to the city put that SNAP program in place to develop our noise ordinance when people are partying and making too much noise. So yeah, City College, I acknowledge that they're at the table and we're talking to them. But it's up to our residents to stay in touch and make sure that our city needs are addressed. And I'm thinking, who comes to park? The students, the staff, the faculty, and visitors. And I need to get a little more nosy about how does City College accommodate their faculty and staff? I'm not exactly sure. So those are questions for us to explore with the new president. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Okay. Thank you for your work on this. It was very thorough and I think came to a really good conclusion. So, sorry?
Make a motion.
Yes, we have a motion. We have a second. Are we ready to go? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, that's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. All right. And now you're really going to talk a lot. Our clerk for item number 23.
Item 23, interim emergency ordinance prohibiting non-medical marijuana-related businesses. Recommendation that Council of the City of Santa Barbara adopt by reading in full and four-fifths vote an interim emergency zoning ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara prohibiting non-medical marijuana-related businesses. All right. Ordinance number blank, an interim emergency zoning ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara prohibiting non-medical marijuana businesses. The County of the City of Santa Barbara does ordain as follows.
I'm sorry, hold on. Mr. Kalan, did you?
Madam Mayor, there's no reason that you don't have to have it read right now, but you could wait until a motion and second if you'd prefer.
Sure, we can do that. All right. Then hold that thought. And, okay, why don't we go on with the staff presentation then? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and City Council. I'm Andrew Bermond with the Community Development Department. I'm going to present briefly on this item so that you can get forward to your discussion and the reading in full. The proposed ordinance is an interim emergency zoning ordinance to prohibit non-medical marijuana related businesses in the City of Santa Barbara. The reason for this is the ballot initiative Proposition 64, which would legalize adult use of marijuana, non-medical marijuana, statewide. Information available to staff shows that it is pretty broadly supported in the state and is quite likely to pass. There is also substantial more financial support for passage than its opposition. If approved by the voters, non-medical marijuana-related businesses would be legal in any zone that allows that particular use, so retail sales would be allowed in any retail zone, et cetera. And this could have adverse effects across the city, as it's a condition that we've not experienced before and have not studied or considered. So staff's proposing an interim ordinance that would prohibit the non-medical marijuana related businesses in any zone citywide, so means of protecting public safety and welfare. The council has the authority to make an emergency interim ordinance effective for 45 days. Council would then have the right to consider extending it up to 2 years. The procedures for adopting an emergency ordinance are a little bit different than we're used to. They're governed by City Charter Section 511, which states that an emergency ordinance must be read in full and that it requires a minimum of 5 affirmative votes, but a higher standard is held by the state, California Government Code Section 65858, which requires 4/5 passage. That's 6 of 7 in our case. So staff's also requesting some guidance on what our long-term solution for non-medical marijuana should be if, in fact, that passes. What we will be looking at in the next year or two would be to identify locations and activities that would be permissible, regulated, or prohibited, and under which zone and under which conditions. That's a community discussion that hasn't happened yet. So staff's recommendation, as has already been stated, is that council adopt by reading in full and with 4/5 vote the interim ordinance, which would be valid for 45 days.
Thank you. Do we have any speaker slips? None. Any questions or comments from council?
No, really.
Mr. Dominguez.
This is maybe a legal question. The language here talks about protect public health, safety, and welfare. Now, marijuana is still a Schedule I controlled substance. Is there any general catch-all provision in our code that prevents businesses from violating federal law or allowing cities to enable businesses to violate federal law?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, I don't think there is. The public health and safety we're referring to here doesn't have anything to do with the use of marijuana. It has to do with the impacts that we don't yet understand about non-medical businesses and where they might land and the effects where they might land. So this isn't really about the legislative choice that the people have to legalize non-medical use. It's about the business end of it here in Santa Barbara.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Hotchkiss?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Kalan, this addresses one particular ballot question or issue. If another passes, that's not this, though, are we still covered? Because at one point we had something like 13 different propositions that were going to be attempted to put on the ballot. I don't know where we stand now, but.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hotchkiss, to my knowledge, Prop 64 is the only one that's qualified. The language of this ordinance is not limited to Prop 64. What I think would be difficult would be, should Prop 64 fail, the need for this interim zoning would go away. So at that point, we would come back to you to repeal the interim ban. And that is, of course, assuming that you choose to extend it beyond 45 days on October 18th when we'd come back for another public hearing.
I understand. Thank you.
Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So, Mr. Kalondik, to further that comment, so if we decide to opt for the maximum amount of time and we seem to feel comfortable about how we've resolved the different ordinance questions and whatnot, we could at that point in time truncate the ban, or that we could say, okay, it's over, we'll go.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, yeah, you can terminate this ordinance or repeal it any time during the 22 months. So 22 months and 15 days added on to the initial 45 days. And honestly, we don't have a recommendation at this point about how long the interim zoning should last. You'll note in the ordinance that the city administrator is delegated a task of reporting to you 10 days before the expiration of the interim zoning about the steps taken to alleviate different conditions. I imagine we'll have some consideration at that point. That's October 11th, about how long it might be extended, if at all.
But logically, it would probably make sense to get the maximum amount of cushion that we could get to develop our own rules and regulations prior to or once this is enacted, if it's in fact voted in.
That's entirely the council's prerogative.
I think if my memory serves correctly, when we were looking at the medical marijuana dispensary ordinance, we had something similar where we had the maximum interim, and then when we finally had the votes for the ordinance, we repealed the interim and then replaced it with the current, so that could be an option. Mr. Hart?
So just so I'm clear, that this takes a unanimous vote today to impose the moratorium, and then what vote requirement would be in place after the 45 days?
Let me check real quickly. I believe it's another 4/5, but I don't remember that off the top of my head. It'll take me 1 second.
Okay, thank you.
And I think for people watching or whatever, this is going to give us maximum flexibility to allow ourselves to know what happens in November. And assuming if Prop 64 passes, gives us the opportunity to do the full public hearings and do the Santa Barbara way of doing these kind of ordinances without having to rush through and without having state law preempt what we want to do here locally. So it makes sense. Go ahead, Mr. Kalan.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. Councilmember Hart, it will take another 4/5 vote for extension.
Okay, so it doesn't automatically go to the longer time period. It takes another unanimous vote. And is that definitive that it takes a unanimous vote, or is it unanimous today because we have one council member missing?
The statute calls for a 4/5 vote of the legislative body. It's ordinarily there are two kinds of votes that we see in statutes. 4/5 of the total voting membership, which would be 6, no matter how many of you are present, or 4/5 of those present and voting, which would be today 5 of 6. This statute's ambiguous about that, so my advice is not to chance it. I think this would require a unanimous vote.
Okay. So the idea is that we're going to take advantage of the 45-day moratorium, then we're going to come back and we will not have resolved this. The election will not even have occurred by that point. So we're going to extend it a longer period in that October date. It seems like we would do that. And then we're going to take the time to do the planning to decide what the ordinance is. But where is this in terms of the resources from staff to do that work? Is that something that's going to be done fairly quickly, or is this likely to take the full what is it, almost 2 years? Is that what, I mean, how long is 200? No, not 2 years, less than a year. Yeah.
Madam Mayor, council members, yes, it will be a staff impact to prepare that ordinance, but I think if the measure passes in November, it's one that I think just de facto kind of elevates itself to being something we need to work on. Whether it takes 1 year or 2 years to kind of do the ordinance work, I think it just depends on consensus at the council level, community input and involvement, and how long that all takes. And I don't have a way to feel that
but
right now.
But your sense is you're going to make it a priority from a staffing standpoint. It's not going to be a workload staffing allocation issue.
I think we're going to have to talk about everything else we're working on, but I think if the initiative passes in November, I think we have to address this.
Okay.
I just think one way or the other, we got to elevate this, and I think by your taking this action, you're already kind of saying this is an issue we want to get ahead of and get done. So I'm taking this kind of as a priority setting action from the council as is.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mr. Dominguez?
I'm not sure if there's a way to work this in today's motion or maybe when we come back in 45 days, but one of the things that came up at a previous hearing was the map that was drawn, and particularly the Milpas area, the way the staff did the 600 feet around each school, it ended up with this unfortunate circumstance where you basically had a donut or bagel where the spot where there wasn't an area within 600 feet of school was actually within a ring of schools. So you kind of have the epicenter of 4,000 K through 12 students right in the center where the allowed spot is. So I'd like to revisit the map and have staff as part of this investigation take a look at that and see if there's an improvement that can be made.
Well, my understanding is this is actually a moratorium on anything to give us the time to do just that when we look at whatever ordinance we need for non-medical marijuana should Prop 64 pass. So all those questions could be looked at very carefully with the time given to put an ordinance together. But today and in 45 days, it's to say nothing's allowed. So that would also solve that issue, at least on an interim basis, while we're working this out. If I'm understanding that correctly, right?
Madam Mayor,
yes,
Assistant City Attorney Ostringer may be able to address the spacing limits that are in Prop 64. They are there. I don't recall them off the top of my head, though.
Ms. Ostrander.
If it's 1,000 feet from a school, I'll have to give me a minute, I can check.
While you're checking, Ms. Murillo, you had your light on.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I think Councilmember Dominguez, you're talking about the medical marijuana ordinance, right? So you're talking about a different ordinance. There was one item that came up for me after we looked at that, was that I was lobbied not to tax medicine. And I think we had put that forward, that would be part of our taxation plan. So I'm with you in reopening that. I don't think this is exactly the venue, but we can check with our legal advisors about how to reopen that particular issue. But I think what I'm hearing you say is we will be making maps, I think, about where marijuana stores can go. And I hear what you're saying. If we have three dispensaries already, and they will be first in line, according to the report that I read from our city attorney, the medical marijuana dispensaries will be first in line to become adult marijuana stores, then we do need to be careful about the maps and sensitive to our neighborhood issues.
Go ahead, Mr. Klon.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Murillo, they might have been first in line had any of them been open and operating by September 1st. That has not happened. So
okay.
As I read Prop 64, there is not a priority for the existing medical dispensaries. Now, that doesn't mean they can't apply to convert. So actually, conversion of the medical dispensaries was a prominent concern among the staff in our office. I want to emphasize that we have inferred from the existing medical storefront dispensary ordinance that the council's policy is consistent with the 1996 Compassionate Use Act initiative, and that was to make sure that qualified patients, people with serious illnesses, had access to medical marijuana to ease the symptoms of those illnesses. That's a pretty limited statement, so we really have no direction as to how the council might want to go with non-medical, and we don't have much information about what the environment will look like when non-medical is approved. The basic concern that we're addressing was the risk that non-medical marijuana stores might pop up in retail locations all around the city without any consideration of those impacts. We don't necessarily know that that's a bad thing, but it's something that ought to be considered.
Madam Mayor, may I continue? Thank you. I think it's prudent to put a moratorium in place so that we can figure out how we might regulate these kinds of sales and storefronts, possibly. But I do know that our youth council wants to have a discussion and make recommendations to us in terms of how legalized marijuana might affect our teenagers. And Dr. David Bierman, who is a medical marijuana, medical cannabis advocate, he was suggesting, he was asking, how can the public make give input if we're formulating regulations? So if I can ask city attorney or city administrator, will there be a hearing, sir, where the public who wants to have a say, how would that
the
work?
Answer will be many.
Correct.
Right.
Sorry?
Going back with how we went through the current dispensary ordinance, they'll be required to have public hearings at Planning Commission, at Council.
Okay.
You know, so there'll be multiple, I'm sure there'll be many opportunities. And I think it's a great idea to bring the Youth Council in. And again, the point of this is so that we have the time to do it right, should Prop 64 pass. So I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
And Ms. Ostrander, you're still looking. Okay. Okay, go ahead. We got more lights on. So, Mr. Hotchkiss?
Seems an appropriate time to make a motion.
Go right ahead.
I'd like to move the staff recommendation. We need a reading in full of this interim zoning ordinance before the council and then a vote, hopefully unanimous. But I make that motion now.
Okay. Is there a second? Second. A motion by Hotchkiss, second by Rouse. Anything else, Mr. Rouse?
Another question for Mr. Cullen, just on the conversion of medical to retail, if that's on the table. One of the issues as we brought up in Colorado was the difference between traffic and parking impacts from a medical dispensary versus a recreational or a retail dispensary. So since this is a land use or a zoning issue, I would assume that would come into play. Is that fair to say that if you did not have appropriate, if your parking could potentially serve a small flow of patients versus a anticipated larger flow of retail customers, wouldn't those be two separate uses under our definition potentially?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, sure. The parking considerations will be big. And the spacing is 600 feet in Prop 64 from schools.
Thank you. Okay. Do we vote first, or do you have to read it first? How does this work? You have to read it first. Okay. Well, sit back, relax, and listen up. Ready? Go ahead.
All right. An interim emergency zoning ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara prohibiting non-medical marijuana businesses. The City Council of the City of Santa Barbara does ordain as follows. Section 1, findings and determinations. Section A, the Adult Use of Marijuana Act, AUMA, is a statewide initiative which will be considered for approval by the people of the State of California on November 8, 2016, as Proposition 64. If approved by the voters, the AUMA would legalize the cultivation, processing, manufacture, distribution, testing, sale, and use by adults over the age of 21 of non-medical marijuana. The AUMA would also give medical marijuana dispensaries operating lawfully before September 1, 2016, a priority in obtaining a non-medical marijuana license. B. Santa Barbara Municipal Code Section 28.10.030A provides as follows. No building or structure shall be erected, moved, altered, added to, or enlarged, nor shall any land, building, structure, or premises be used, designed or intended to be used for any purpose or in any manner other than is permitted in the zones in which such landing, building, structure, or premises are located. C. The City Council finds that SBMC 28.10.030A establishes permissive zoning, which does not permit any land use, including non-medical and medical marijuana uses, unless such use is expressly identified, enumerated, and authorized in the zoning ordinance. D. The City Council wishes to assure that non-medical marijuana businesses are not permitted, licensed, opened, or operated in Santa Barbara until such time as a community development, finance, fire, police, and other city departments have had a reasonable opportunity to study the ramifications of non-medical marijuana businesses and report their findings to the Planning Commission and City Council so that appropriate land use decisions can be made to regulate the locations, activities, and operating parameters of such businesses. E. The establishment of non-medical marijuana businesses before appropriate procedures and regulations are enacted will cause adverse impacts to surrounding residential and non-residential neighborhoods, an unacceptable risk to the public health, safety, and welfare of the city's residents and the general public, and it is therefore urgent that the city have the opportunity to consider whether such facilities should be allowed or prohibited in the city, and, if so allowed, to develop regulations governing the location and operation of non-medical marijuana businesses to prevent the adverse impacts to the public health, safety, and welfare that could result from the unregulated placement and operation of such uses. F. Given the time required to undertake the necessary study and planning, the City Council finds that it is necessary that this interim ordinance be immediately enacted to ensure that no non-medical marijuana businesses that may be in conflict with any state or federal law or the city's general plan, zoning, and or development policies are permitted in the interim. G. Based on the foregoing, the City Council finds that there is a current and immediate threat to the public health, safety, and welfare presented by the unregulated development and operation of non-medical marijuana businesses. H. The City Council finds and determines that the current and immediate preservation of the public health, safety, and welfare requires that this interim ordinance be enacted as an interim zoning ordinance pursuant to Government Code Section 65858 and an emergency ordinance pursuant to City Charter Section 511 and take effect immediately upon adoption, and its urgency is hereby declared. I. The City intends to undertake within a reasonable time of study whether non-medical marijuana businesses must or should be permitted or prohibited, and if permitted, the appropriate regulations for such uses. J. The City Council has held a duly noticed public hearing in connection with the consideration and adoption of this ordinance. K. The City Council now desires to adopt this interim ordinance as an emergency ordinance effective immediately and prohibit the establishment of non-medical marijuana businesses as defined hereafter in any zone of the city pursuant to the authority set forth in California Government Code Section 65858. L. The City Council finds that this ordinance should be read in full and adopted on an emergency basis pursuant to the authority in Charter Section 511. Section 2. Interim zoning adopted. The findings and determinations in Section 1 are true and correct. B. In accordance with the authority granted to the City Council under Government Code Section 65858 and City Charter Section 511, from and after the date of this interim zoning ordinance, no use permit, variance, building permit, business license, or other applicable entitlement for use of any kind whatsoever shall be approved or issued for the establishment or operation of a non-medical marijuana business, nor shall any non-medical marijuana business be allowed to open, operate, or seek permits to open or operate for a period of 45 days, and during that period, any such activity shall be unlawful. C. For the purposes of this ordinance, the following definitions shall apply. 1. Marijuana shall have the same meaning as cannabis under Business and Professions Code Section 13900.5F as enacted by Chapter 32 of the Statutes of 2016. 2. Non-medical marijuana shall mean any marijuana or marijuana product of any kind whatsoever that is not expressly permitted by 1. The City of Santa Barbara for medical use pursuant to 2. Santa Barbara Municipal Code Chapter 28.80 or Santa Barbara Municipal Code Section 28.87.300 or 2. The State of California for medical use pursuant to the Compassionate Use Act of 1996, Health and Safety Code Section 11362.5 et sec. 3. Non-medical marijuana business shall mean a non-medical marijuana business of any kind whatsoever, whether licensed by under state law or not, and whether operated for profit or not, including but not limited to A. A commercial, as defined by Santa Barbara Municipal Code Section 28.04.180, non-medical marijuana activity or enterprise. B. Any business, as defined by Santa Barbara Municipal Code Section 5.04.0102, involving or related to non-medical marijuana operating in any manner within the City of Santa Barbara. C. cultivation activities, including but not limited to the planting, growing, harvesting, drying, curing, grading, or trimming of non-medical marijuana. D, delivery of non-medical marijuana, including but not limited to commercial transfer of marijuana or marijuana products to a customer. E, distribution activities, including but not limited to procurement, sale, and local transport of non-medical marijuana and sale of marijuana between non-medical marijuana businesses. F, manufacturing activities, including but not limited to compounding, blending, extracting, infusing, testing, or otherwise making or preparing a non-medical marijuana product. G, storage of non-medical marijuana. H, transportation of non-medical marijuana from locations outside the city of Santa Barbara to locations inside the city of Santa Barbara. D, this ordinance is an interim emergency ordinance adopted pursuant to the authority granted to the City Council by Government Code Section 65858 and City Charter Section 511. It is necessary for the immediate preservation of the public health, safety, and welfare. The facts constituting the emergency and urgency as stated in Section 1 of this ordinance are incorporated herein by this reference. E, the city administrator acting by and through such city departments as he or she may deem appropriate is directed to study the applicable legal and land use issues related to operation of non-medical marijuana businesses and develop appropriate zoning and licensing guidelines or regulations governing such uses and or a possible prohibition on such uses if authorized by law and desired by the City Council. F, the city administrator acting on behalf of the City Council is directed to issue a written report not later than 10 days before the expiration of this ordinance describing the measures taken to alleviate the conditions which led to the adoption of this ordinance. G, the violation of any of the provisions of this ordinance shall be a misdemeanor and shall be punishable by a fine not to exceed $1,000 or by imprisonment for a period not to exceed 6 months or by both such fine and imprisonment. Each and every day such a violation exists shall constitute a separate and distinct violation of this ordinance. Any violation is also subject to the penalties established by Santa Barbara Municipal Code Chapter 1.28 and the Administrative Code Enforcement Procedures established by Santa Barbara Municipal Code Section Chapter 1.25. H, in addition to the penalties and other methods of enforcement provided herein, any condition caused or permitted to exist in violation of this provision of the ordinance shall be deemed a public nuisance and may be by this city summarily abated as such. The city attorney is authorized to commence actions and proceedings for abatement, removal, or enjoyment thereof in the manner provided by law and shall take such other steps as necessary and shall apply to any court as may have jurisdiction to grant relief for such abatement, removal, or enjoyment. Each day that such condition continues shall be regarded as a new and separate offense. I, the city attorney, is hereby authorized to commence any legal and administrative actions and proceedings for the abatement, removal, or enjoyment of non-medical marijuana businesses and shall take such other legal actions and steps as he or she may deem necessary and shall apply to the court as may have jurisdiction to grant relief for abatement, removal, or enjoyment on non-medical marijuana businesses which are prohibited by this ordinance. Section 3, severability interpretation. A, severability. If any provision of this interim emergency ordinance or the application thereof to any persons or circumstances is held invalid, such an invalidity shall not affect other provisions or applications of this interim emergency ordinance, which can be given effect without the invalid provision or application. And to this end, the provisions of this interim emergency ordinance are hereby declared to be severable. B, interpretation. This interim emergency ordinance shall be construed to confer upon the city the maximum power and authority allowed by state and federal law. In the event state or federal law is found to conflict with and preempt any provision of this ordinance, or in the event state or federal law changes to conflict with and prevent any provision of this ordinance, the remaining and non-conflicting provisions of this ordinance shall be interpreted and construed to give maximum effect to the remaining and non-conflicting provisions so as to effectuate the greatest extent possible the purposes and restrictions expressed herein. Section 4, effective date. This interim emergency ordinance shall be effective immediately upon adoption and shall be in effect for 45 days from the day of adoption. It may be extended by the City Council as provided in Government Code Section 65858A. Section 5, CEQA findings. The City Council, on the basis of the whole record and exercising its independent judgment, finds that this interim emergency ordinance is not subject to environmental review pursuant to the state guidelines for implementation of the California Environmental Quality Act, Sections 15060C2 and 15060C3, pertaining to activities that will not result in a direct or reasonably foreseeable indirect change to the environment and that are not defined as a project under Section 15378. This ordinance has no potential for resulting in physical change to the environment, directly or indirectly, in that it prevents change to the environment pending the completion of the contemplated research and studies.
Thank you. Okay, we have a motion and a second. It was read in full. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that's unanimous. All right. Thank you very much. That concludes that item. We moved on to Council Member Committee Assignment Reports. Ms. Murillo.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I attended my assignments over the break. The Neighborhood Advisory Council discussed capital improvement projects. The Living Wage Ordinance Committee talked about, it's an ongoing discussion about the wage tiers, whether just to make it one wage now that we have the Affordable Care Act. The ENZO, the new zoning ordinance, the updating our zoning ordinance, we talked about when land uses change, will the parking requirements change? That was a very interesting discussion. And a lot of people are talking about taco trucks right now. We also looked at mobile vending on private property. And if you care about your taco trucks, people should tune into what the city's proposing, the regulations that we're proposing. I was at the MTD board meeting, and the discussion was about new fuels and hybrids and energy sources for buses. And the library board discussed digital content, and that's terribly interesting. And I renewed my library card. And the fun things that I did was the Weihai visit. We had a big delegation come from China, and here we are with 90,000 in our city. They have 2.8 million people in their city, so that was really impressive. And they were very nice people. The Pride Festival was a lot of fun, and then in my community work, the Pro Youth Movement met, talked about the Ethnic Studies Now campaign, and our West Side Community Group met, and the topic was water conservation. And I thank Madeline Ward for coming and talking to us about how we can all save a little bit more water. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I got to cut the ribbon in front of a very enthusiastic crowd for the new Vons on the Mesa, which is now open and ready to roll. So happy campers up there.
Finally, that's good. Anything else? Okay. I would like to adjourn this meeting in memory and honor of the man known as Mr. Santa Barbara, Larry Crandell, who passed away just recently and very well known to all of us, very, very much involved in many, many different Santa Barbara activities. We have the Larry Crandell Room in the Louise Lowry Davis Center. He was emceed quite a bit, the 90-plus year birthday party that the Parks and Rec Department puts on. I know there's a group of people who are working with their family on a memorial service sometime in October, so I hope to hear more about that soon. So we're going to adjourn today's meeting in his honor and memory. And with that, we are adjourned.
Thank you.